from San Francisco, California. This is the Rock and Roll Geek Show.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name's Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Tuesday, August 10th, 2021, and it's 5:17 p.m. when I'm recording this episode. I have had a rough day today. My back, my Tourette's is acting up. My back is killing me. It's been a tiring day at work. I lost the keys to the customer's house. She's out of town, and hopefully she's not listening to this. It's been a rough one for me. So I need to crack open the first Tecate of the day. Oh, it is so true what they say about the best one of the day. Oh, it's been a long one, but I'm here. I was going to do maybe a longer show tonight, but I just ain't got it in me, friends. I apologize, but I'm going to do my best to power through this one because I am suffering for my podcast art. I got the grill fired up right now. Let me turn off my phone. The grill's fired up. The Kamado Joe in the homemade Kamado Joe table that I made by myself by hand. I have some wild boar sausage, and I cut up some red bell peppers, some green bell peppers, and some onions. And I'm going to throw all those things on the grill, and I'm going to have me some sausage and peppers tonight for dinner. It's going to be nice. I'm going to enjoy it. I kind of like being here by myself. I miss the wife and I miss the other dogs. My one dog that's here with me, Stella, she's just crying constantly, and she really is pissed off that she can't be up there running around in the woods. Wife saw a bear in the day, a young bear, like a teenage, almost a bear, a cub, by itself on the other side of the river, and we have not seen any of those in the daytime. So I'm thinking the fires might have caused the wildlife to head our way. So that was exciting, and yeah, but I'm enjoying being here by myself because I can cook and I can eat whatever I want. And tonight I'm just having a caveman feast, wild boar sausage and peppers. Looking forward to that. I have an audio comment. I think this is from somebody named Tabitha. I think she might be the bathtub mermaid from one of. This is day 10 of the Dog Days of Podcasting, by the way, where I attempt to do a show a day for the rest of August. And I think Tabitha might be one of the shows that's participating in the Dog Days. DogDaysOfPodcasting.com. Let's hear what she has to say.
Hi, Michael Butler. Hello. This is Tabs. And once again, I'm sending you a fairly out of your show commentary. Okay. But, you know, I actually really love listening to the show.
Do I need to find the Ass Kissing with Butler?
Even when you say what you made for dinner, because it gives me some great ideas. But I love the show, the live show reviews, and I really enjoyed hearing about your tour stories. So please do more of those.
Okay, thank you. I will do one of those after your comment, Tabitha. I appreciate it. And thank you for the kind words. Back to you.
But I am going to talk about another subject that I learned from you and some of the other people back in the day. Recently, we adopted two boys.
And is Tabitha. I think she's a bathtub mermaid. She adopted two. I saw this on the Dog Is a Podcasting website or Facebook group, Tabitha.
Adoption community, they were talking about this great new thing called a...
Hold on, let me back it up here.
And in the adoption community, they were talking about this great new thing called a Yeti cooler. And I'm like, yes. I'm pretty sure I've known about these for years.
This great new thing called the Yeti cooler. I have two Yetis. I have an RTIC as well. I have my lunchbox is an RTIC soft-sided cooler, which is a knockoff of the Yeti soft-sided cooler. I have another one that's going to replace this one because the zipper's going on it. I have a 30-can RTIC soft-sided Yeti knockoff as well, and have a couple of hard Yeti coolers as well, and several Yeti knockoff beer koozies.
Where are these people like just now discovering? And then it was like this huge thing. There was
let me back it up here. I'm sorry for interrupting.
Like just now discovering. And then it was like this huge thing.
Back it up a little bit farther. I apologize.
Sure. I've known about these for years. Where are these people like just now discovering? And then it was like this huge thing. There was giveaways for Yeti cooler. All of these things. And then I realized listening this year to the Dog Days of Podcast that I heard it from folks like you.
Yeah.
About how great the Yeti coolers and cozies and whatever.
Pardon me. Let me give you a tip. Go to RTIC or just Google RTIC coolers. The exact same coolers. The hard cider ones, they're the exact same coolers, except they're about half the price. You'll thank me for it. And there's plenty of other brands as well, but Yeti or the RTIC. But I do own two Yetis because Don bought me one and he gave me his old one, smaller one.
Or Yeti makes where, and I was like, oh, this is like podcasting all over again. People are like, oh, this new thing called podcasting. I'm like, I was back in 2006 when I was podcasting. Yeah, okay, never mind. Yeah. But yeah, I thought that would amuse you because you have brought a lot of new things into my life just through the Dog Days of Podcast. And please keep doing your show. And
I will.
People like me will still listen,
thank
even
you
though that. It's not directly in my geekdom.
Yes.
It's really fun because you make it a really enjoyable show. So
I
thanks.
Appreciate
Bye.
That. Thank you, Tabitha. That is very nice of you to say. And I was going to say something else about you, but I forgot. So, but thank you for the comment. Please keep the audio comments coming. You too can leave me an audio comment. Just record it into your phone like Tabs did and email it to me, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. I've been podcasting Tabs since 2004. When I started, and I've told this a million times, when I started, there was about six podcasts. I think it might have been less than six, but yeah. Me and Dave Slusher and I have the longest running podcasts in existence. Evil Genius Chronicles number one, Rock and Roll Geek Show number two. Daily Source Code was the first, but he's not doing Daily Source Code anymore, so that leaves me and Dave Slusher. All right, let me take another sip of this fine Tecate, and I will tell you a little tour story from Exodus. Steve Souza, Steve Zetro Souza, just I saw this on Blabbermouth. He has a show called Zetro's Toxic Vault, which he has a little set set up in a place where we practice at Ace Cook's studio in Oakland. The Butlers practice there sometimes, and Featherwitch has practiced there. Ace is one of the guys, is the sound man, and he's got a recording studio, or not a recording studio, but a rehearsal studio that a bunch of bands practice at, including, and Zetro does his Zetro's Toxic Vault there. And he was talking about when I was in Exodus, we went to South America, or Argentina more specifically, to play with a couple of shows with Motorhead. And he was talking about, he had Chris Kontos on his show. Chris Kontos was one of the a drummer for Machine Head, and he came down, this was about, I don't know what year, maybe 93 maybe, or maybe 94, I don't know, but this was about the time we got dropped from Capitol, and John Tempesta had already quit the band, and Chris Kontos filled in for us down in South America, in Argentina. We were going to do two shows with Motorhead, and Detcher was talking about he and Rick Hunolt, the guitar player for Exodus, one of the guitar players, bought Speed from Lemmy. I don't remember them buying Speed, but I do remember Lemmy and all of his band doing a lot of Speed backstage. And we all stayed in the same hotel. There was this really nice hotel right in downtown Argentina. And I remember when we were coming back, when we were arriving from the airplane, we took this airline called Varig Airlines or something like that. We were in transit like 22 hours. We went to, flew to Miami, sat in Miami airport for a long time, then flew to Sao Paulo, Brazil, I think. I could be wrong about that, but it's one of the, wherever they have Rio, maybe it was Rio de Janeiro we flew into. I don't know. But we flew somewhere into Brazil, into South America, and then we had a layover there. Then we took another puddle jumper or a small plane into Argentina, and then we got into this car that was waiting for us. And this car, I remember it was flying through the streets of Argentina. I thought we were going to crash. It was crazy. So we get to the hotel. Turns out somebody from the band Menudo was staying in the hotel. Could have been Ricky Martin. Was he in Menudo? I don't know. But this was before Ricky Martin had a hit. So maybe it was Ricky Martin if he was in Menudo. But anyway, somebody from Menudo was staying there. So there were hundreds, and I mean literally hundreds, maybe even more than hundreds, of girls camped outside the hotel room. So we pull up out of our I guess you call it an SUV type limo, and they thought we were in one of the, they thought we were Ricky Martin or whoever that was. And so we all walk out of this thing like rock stars, and then you could see the look of disappointment in their faces when they saw these metal guys coming out of the van. But it was a good time, and you could not leave the hotel because first of all, I was in a bad part of town, and so we just went up to our hotel. I think we hung out in the hotel bar, but you could see people staring in the windows at all times. It was a very surreal moment. So the two gigs we did with Motorhead were at this, I guess it was like a hockey rink or a small hockey ring, and Chris Kontos from Machine Head filled in, and we were about to get dropped if we had not already been dropped. But I remember the guys in Motorhead were really cool guys. They were all totally, you know, they were very cordial to us. And I remember watching Motorhead sound check, and we all hung out at the hotel together. These guys were doing speed backstage like it was breakfast. And I did not buy any speed from Motorhead, like Zetter said he and Rick Hunolt did. But I remember there was this girl and her friend. Somehow, after the second night, I think we did two shows, one night, and then the following night we did a show. Both shows sold out. Do not remember a thing about the actually being on stage at these shows. But after the second show, we all went to this discotheque or some famous bar or whatever, and we got to sit in the VIP section. I remember this guy, as we were walking in, yelling at us, and he was like, Argentinian guy, and he, "You Americans, you're filthy Americans, you come here, you steal our girlfriends, you rock stars, you come steal." We're like, what the fuck is going on? And these girls who were at the show came into the VIP section with us. And I remember them giving me a bunch of speed, and I think I might have done one line. I'm not a drug person, so I remember when she gave me the one line. She gave me a bunch of speed, and the guys in Exodus found out that I was holding speed, and I became the most popular guy of the evening. I pretty much gave it to all them, and I did one maybe two lines. And I remember after this bar, Tony Isabella, the manager of Exodus, supposedly had me lined up to be the bass player for Duff McKagan's new punk rock band. And I remember talking to these girls about, hey, I'm going to be playing with Duff McKagan pretty soon. And that never happened. Tony, apparently did not make that happen. Anyway, the guys in Exodus were following me around all night wanting my speed. So I just gave them my speed. And after this night of partying, I remember sitting in my hotel room, because we each had our own hotel room. We were traveling first class in this thing. And not first class plane seating, but just first class once we got to Argentina. And I remember it being at the hotel room, high on speed, staring at the fucking ceiling of the hotel, could not sleep the entire night. I said, all right, I guess I'll sleep on the plane on the way back, because we had to leave the next morning. And I think we're on Varig Airlines. I remember everybody in the plane, everybody in the Exodus party complaining about this plane. It was a rickety jet, and we were flying through storms. I've never felt so much turbulence, and I remember everybody in the Exodus party going, "Get me out of this death tube." It was turbulence for the entire flight. So I'm thinking I'm going to get some sleep on the plane after being up all night doing speed, or did two lines of speed and being up all night because I couldn't get to sleep. I'm gripping, along with all the other guys in Exodus who were also tweaked from the night before, we're all gripping the armchairs of our seats, scared shitless. I thought this plane was going down. So, needless to say, I got no sleep. The plane, it was like 23 hours to get back from Argentina. But all that trouble, it was still good times. And I will say this again, being in Exodus was the funnest time I have ever had in my entire life. And I miss those days, and I cherish the memories. So that's a little bit of another tour story I remember. I will try to remember more and bring them up as I'm going along in the Dog Days of Podcasting. I think I'll try to remember some more American Heartbreak, maybe some Stevie Stiletto stories from way back. Some of them that I've been writing about in the book, or that I wrote about in the book. Sorry for repeating for stuttering and stuff. I'm exhausted from a tough day, and my back is killing me. I can't make excuses. I got a really bad Tourette's going on right now, too. One more sip of Tecate. So I hope you're enjoying these tour stories and everything else I'm doing on the Dog Days of Podcasting. Please keep the audio comments coming, because without these audio comments, I'm going to be talking about what I'm having for dinner. Tomorrow, I may do a track-by-track of an album. I have the new Night Ranger. I have the new Doogie White album. I don't know what his band's called. Doogie White. Tim Binder, my friend, who is a radio promo guy, has sent me a bunch of music. But I would rather be doing your audio comments. But there might be a track-by-track tomorrow. Maybe I'll do the a cold track-by-track of the Night Ranger. That might be fun. Pardon me, I'm burping up this fine Tecate. But let's close out the show now. Something from Exodus, the album I played on, Force of Habit. A song called Count Your Blessings. Now, the guys in Exodus shunned this album because they said it's a sellout album and it's not very heavy and this and that. Listen to this song. You tell me it's not heavy. I think this album's going to go down in history as one of Exodus's crowning achievements, even though it didn't sell shit and was our last Capitol album and it got us dropped. I think the album stands the test of time. 7 minutes and 31 seconds. The song is called Count Your Blessings from Force of Habit. The record cover is done by Ralph Steadman. Thank you for listening, friends. Here's how you can reach me, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. You can find this show at rockandrollgeek.com. Find me on the Facebook, R&R Geek. There's a Rock and Roll Geek Facebook group, which I did not create, but I do approve people. You just have to answer two questions so that I know you're not somebody from Andrew Cuomo's camp trying to get him back into office the hard way. Okay, I don't know where I'm reaching with this. Find me on the Twitter, R&R Geek. Find me on the Instagram, Rockandrol Geek. Don't ask. There's a Featherwitch show coming up on Friday in Albany at the Ivy Room. If you're around the Bay Area, come say hello, friends. Send me an email. I can try to put you on the guest list. I don't know how many guests I'll get, but I do my best, friends. All right. Here's Exodus. Count your blessings. I will talk to you tomorrow. We'll be right back.
It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.